We are glad that you joined us today to see and hear our story. It is a story about two communities, Greater Haverhill and Greater Lawrence. Also, a story about its people and a company that came into these communities and was welcomed more than 40 years ago. Of course, the company is AT&T Network Systems. And after today's show, we hope you will have a better understanding of who we are. We arrived in Haverhill in 1943. However, what you may not realize is that our roots go back much further. All the way back to 1870, when a Haverhill resident by the name of Tom Sanders called for a Canadian school teacher to come and work with his deaf son, George. The teacher was Alexander Graham Bell, and that is the beginning of our story. Mr. Bell moved into Mr. Sanders' house, still located on Canosa Avenue in Haverhill, and along with his teaching, he continued to pursue an idea that voice could be transmitted over wires. By the way, the Sanders house is the site of the first installation of a telephone in the city and was hooked up to Mr. Sanders' downtown office in Washington Square. Haverhill looked a bit different in those days. Shopping was a whole lot less hectic, and parking was plentiful. Also, you might notice that we were in the horse and buggy days and not even cobblestone roads, but dirt roads. If you will notice in this slide, there is Macy's Department Store on the left-hand side. The world-famous Macy's of New York City started in Haverhill April 5th, 1851. However, Mr. Macy did not make it in Haverhill, and he had to liquidate his stock in 1855. The major industry during the 1800s was shoe manufacturing, which became a booming business and was responsible for Haverhill's reference as the slipper city of the world. Shoe manufacturing was done in buildings such as these under construction. Working conditions left a lot to be desired. Cutting leather was one facet of the business, and sewing shoes was another. Mr. Bell, who moved from Haverhill to Boston in 1875, set up his shop at 109 Court Street, pictured here, and continued to prove his theory that the human voice could be transmitted over wires. Bell's workshop still remains intact and is on display at 9X headquarters in Boston, a part of New England Telephone. Bell finally succeeded in proving that the voice could indeed be transmitted over wires. And on March 10th, 1876, the famous line, "Mr. Watson, come here, I want you," was spoken. The first switchboard was installed in a building at 342 Washington Street in Boston, shown here. Meanwhile, Lawrence, which was hailed as the new city on the Merrimack River, was founded in 1845 and beginning to show development as a result of construction that took place along the river. The Essex Company, which was formed with the purpose of harnessing water power on the Merrimack, constructed the first stone dam to control the river. The site of the dam was at Bodwell Falls, a sparsely populated farm which was then a part of North Andover and Methuen. Construction was also begun on the North Canal at this time. Very shortly thereafter, mills began dotting the Merrimack River. Alexander Graham Bell came to Lawrence again after his invention of the telephone and decided to go on a lecturing tour to show his invention to the public. This handbill advertised one of those lectures which he gave at the Lawrence City Hall in the early 1880s. Mr. Bell never forgot his old friend Tom Sanders, and in repayment of the earlier financial support that Sanders gave Mr. Bell, he issued 1,497 shares of original Bell Telephone Company stock. This was only the fourth stock certificate issued by the new company. 67 years after Bell's invention, AT&T Network Systems, then known as Western Electric, moved to Haverhill, an extension of the Kearney, New Jersey works. It's interesting to note that Mr. Bell came back to Haverhill as Western Electric after he originally was introduced to the city in 1870. The original manufacturing needs were the result of war demands. However, after the war ended, peacetime requirements increased so much that there was need to expand beyond the capacity of Haverhill, and AT&T Network Systems purchased the former Merrimack Mills on South Union Street in Lawrence, making Western Electric a part of the Lawrence community as well as Haverhill. By 1952, the unprecedented demands for transmission equipment assigned to the Lawrence and Haverhill shops required a major expansion, and so construction was started in 1953 on a 169-acre tract of land located in North Andover and sitting between the Lawrence and Haverhill lines. The construction of the new facility in North Andover, containing 1 million square feet of manufacturing space, took about 3 years to complete. The building was occupied in April of 1956. Here we see a picture of an aerial view showing the building almost near completion and the parking lots. This is the picture of the entrance to the building in April of 1956 when it was first inhabited. During the next 20 years, there were to be 8 major expansions to this giant manufacturing complex. Today, we have almost 1.75 million square feet of floor space. The perimeter of the building is about a mile. There are 34 acres of parking, 25 acres of green lawn, and we even have 4 softball athletic fields and 2 miles of private roads. In 1969, AT&T Network Systems placed its environmental commitment up front by investing over $1 million in a waste treatment plant to ensure no chemical waste or sewage would enter the Merrimack River. The Merrimack Valley Works is really a little town all of its own, with more than 9,000 residents. These are many of the communities where our people come from, generally Greater Haverhill, Greater Lawrence, and Southern New Hampshire. However, our people come from more than 130 cities and towns. Here are some other facts about ourselves. 1.7 million square feet of floor space, 9,500 employees as of the end of 1984. And also statistical figures showing capital investment, purchases, and payroll. We have our own police force of 35 guards, and we have our own fire department internally with 50 trained firefighters. We have a medical department which, like a small hospital, has emergency rooms, 4 doctors, 8 nurses, and an x-ray technician who handles 30,000 clinical visits a year. We have our own school system providing training in various blue-collar and white-collar job skills and management training. We also have the facilities for vocational training and testing and evaluation. No town would be complete without its own restaurant. Our cafeteria serves approximately 5,000 meals daily, or about 1.2 million meals a year. And we have a recreational club, which arranges tours, dances, and other social activities. They also supervise all of our athletic events, such as softball, soccer, and bowling. The Telephone Pioneers of America, Chapter 78, is an organization made up of 18-year service employees who are dedicated to help the less fortunate, handicapped, the blind, the retarded, the deaf, and others. Pioneers do make a difference, which is the motto. We provide services such as flea markets so that in turn we can make money to help the less fortunate in our communities. We provide therapeutic devices so that the deaf and the blind can be aided in living a life such as you and me. We make the audio ball, which is a conventional softball in which we insert a beeper module. We then stitch the softball back up, and the softball provides the blind with the ability to actually play baseball. The audio ball is manufactured exclusively at the Merrimack Valley Works by retirees who come in every Tuesday morning and make the audio ball on their own time. We have a computer center for data processing. Our storerooms maintain a weekly shelf inventory in parts and materials, requiring careful inventory control, all done by computers. To keep the Merrimack Valley Works in the forefront of technology in the telecommunications field, we have a core of very talented and imaginative engineers. Our engineering organization comprises more than 700 employees. We don't manufacture telephones at Merrimack Valley Works. Merrimack Valley manufactures transmission equipment instead, which carries your voice from one point to another. It enables wires, underground cables, radio beams, and light beams to carry more than one telephone call at a time. That way, individual telephone lines between your telephone and all the telephones you call are not necessary. Imagine what your streets and telephone lines would look like if each person were required to have a line running from his house to all the other homes being called. With the use of Merrimack Valley's transmission equipment, millions of people can talk from city to city and country to country over one underground cable at the same time without interfering with one another. This shows the advancements in electronic engineering, with the vacuum tube on the left, followed by the transistor, invented by Bell Labs in 1947, and most widely used now, the silicon integrated circuit on the tip of the person's finger. We will refer from now on to the silicon integrated circuit as the SIC. This is a magnification of the SIC. It's fantastic to remember that the silicon integrated circuit can now do the job of what 150,000 transistors once did. The introduction of integrated circuits using thin and thick film circuits has rapidly reduced the size of many of our products. Here we see a hybrid integrated circuit, which combines the SIC and the film integrated circuit. Microscopes are used in this process because of the high degree of miniaturization involved. The integrated circuit technology allows us to put hundreds of components within a space the size of a stamp. This advanced circuitry requires skilled hands and good eyesight to produce. The laser trimming machine shown here utilizes a camera and screen to allow the operator to view the resistance value being placed on the ceramic substrate. A recent innovation is the use of lasers for cutting miniature HIC substrates. We have over 40 lasers in use now at the Merrimack Valley Works by specially trained operators, and they are working 24 hours a day. As a matter of fact, this is one of our large components now, because within a few months, we will be bringing in a transfer of work from Hawthorne in Chicago, and our laser trimming procedure of thin and thick film will increase from 300 employees to as many as 1,000. A separate building for cultured quartz crystal operations was built in 1959. The building houses 36 vessels for growing the cultured quartz. Each vessel is 10 inches in diameter and 10 feet deep. It takes about 38 days for the quartz to grow from the nutrient. The nutrient is chips of natural quartz. This rack of crystal is the end product after the 38-day growth cycle. The quartz is grown under 25,000 pounds of pressure at a temperature of 750 degrees Fahrenheit. This slide shows a comparison between the natural and cultured crystal. The natural is on the left-hand side of the slide, and the cultured is in the upper right-hand side. The wafers are made into crystal units, and the frequency of the crystal unit depends on the size and shape of the wafer seen in the lower part of the right-hand side of the slide. The thinner the wafer, the higher the frequency, and the converse is also true. Here is one of the automatic coil winding machines which wind from 4 to 12 coils simultaneously in the making of magnetic transmission equipment, such as transformers. It is interesting to note this part of our work dates back to 1943, when we arrived in Haverhill. However, back then, all of the manufacturing of transformers was done manually. We had no automatic coil winding machines. Later on, when we moved into North Andover, we manufactured our own winding machines, and it became an automatic procedure. This phase of our manufacturing process has since moved to Radford, Virginia. This machine, of which we have four, is called the Gardner Denver Automatic Wiring Unit. They are futuristic in application in that they're not controlled anymore by numerically controlled tape, but instead, all of our Gardner Denver machines are controlled by a centralized computer. The copper-plated printed wiring boards provide the foundation for the inserted components. Here, the printed wiring boards are screened. This process screens their protective image on a panel known as a PWB, and exposed copper is etched off through a procedure that uses acid and water. Here we see several of the machines used in screening, and here we see the automatic drilling machine, known as an Exelon machine. And it provides the holes in the printed wiring board so that components can be inserted later on. One of the recent additions to our shop area is the A-line material transporter, which moves transmission components to bench workers for hand insertion into printed wiring boards. These individual components are resistors, capacitors, diodes, and transformers. This is an in-bank testing area adjacent to the A-line for making electronic tests after the components have been inserted in the PWBs. If the components are to be machine inserted, the components must first be sequenced in the proper order. This operation is handled by this machine. Then the components are machine inserted, as shown here. This is a close-up of hand inspection. Some of the components are too large to be machine inserted and has to be done by hand. All of the connections are then soldered at once by means of mass soldering techniques, as this gentleman is doing in the shop. When these steps are done, the units are inspected for quality of assembly and tested to ensure a high standard of quality. They are stored temporarily in this modern Triax retriever. This three-story high automated unit has 1,800 storage locations and is operated by one man. The final product is then shipped as completed packages and bay frames. This slide shows a telephone company technician making final adjustments to our finished product that has been installed in the central office. To all of you who have joined us today on this presentation, I thank you very much for your attention, and I wish you the best of luck at the Merrimack Valley Works.